No, when you were, to me, like I said, Jimmy Walker was a god because I was impressionable.
Right.
So those are the ones.
What you mean, yeah.
Yeah. So I was at a, my friend Steve Scroven had a
surprise. And then when they're nice to you, I've learned this in my lifetime. There's guys that suck as comics,
yeah.
But they're nice to me, and I'll just tell everybody to their face, he's the greatest comic.
Yeah.
Because he's nice. Because the nice trumps everything.
I know.
That's all it takes for me these days.
It's all, like, now
just
I'm on Twitter.
Nice.
Now if someone follows me, hey, Rosie O'Donnell, love her. You know, wow. But you know, there's a thing with Twitter. What gets me nervous is I'll see someone follows me, hey, and then you click on, you want to send a message. They don't follow me. Like, either that's the thing they do. They follow you. I'll follow you back. Great. Eddie Pepitone, whoever. Then you see they don't follow you. What did I do? Bad tweets. Like, Norm MacDonald abandoned me with tweeting. The guy from Sons of Anarchy.
What's weird is they don't follow
you. Kurt Sutter. You know him, right?
Yeah. Matt Cohen knows him. But what's weird about when people don't follow you and you look at their page, they follow 310 people. I emailed Colin Quinn. I said, you follow 152 people and I'm not fucking one of them? Like, you're following strangers.
Yeah, but you're more. I know what you're gonna do, more.
You never know, you know. I gotta follow this mattress company because if I need a new mattress, they'll take the old one out for me, you know. And I don't want to carry a mattress down two flights of stairs. Why do you mind your business?
So you take the girl out in your parents' car because you figured they've lived enough. Let you have some life.
Wendy will only go out with me if I get the car.
You have the car.
Oh,
you go see Brenner. He kills.
Yeah, and Robert.
And then
you wind up
writing for him on.
He had Nightlife with David Brenner.
Yeah. So you wrote – that was one of your first writing gigs?
Well, what happened was I did his show, and I was supposed to be the Chris Elliott of it, meaning little bits.
Man Under the Stairs, Man in the Street stuff, little
and
remotes.
Yeah, I did a few. And then there was these resentful writers who would go, why aren't you writing topical jokes? I remember – and I couldn't do it. They go, Freddie doesn't participate. He's selfish. I would pitch a joke, and the head writer, he was an ex-comic, so he wanted to be on it. So he goes, what is it for you? I go, well, I can't do topical jokes. And I thought I was hired. They told me. And everyone turned on me. And I remember the topical jokes was Spring.
And this is like late 80s, right?
Yeah, Spring. The big things was Springsteen had some first live album and everyone, Springsteen has more money than God. Every joke was him or some Madonna things.
It was Bruce Springsteen, 1975 to 1985.
Right.
Well, could it be that old, like a 1985 show?
Yes. Okay. So it was 86.
That was the live. That was
the live
album.
Thing that was gazillions.
And it was four discs.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I'm with you.
And everything joke was Madonna or Springsteen.
And Madonna's hairy armpits.
Yeah. Like a virgin, yeah. And so so then I that didn't last.
Let me tell you right now, you're coming back to this podcast on a regular basis.
Oh, I hope.
I could listen to you all day.
No. It's Andy Dick was like, like, they kept shoving him an iPad with Fred Stoller's IMBD. So, you were a regular, and he kind of was that
podcast?
He got up to pee, yeah, and I kind of felt sorry for him. You know, he goes, David Strickland, they blame me, and he became Jiminy Glick, Andy Dick. Like,
that's right.
You know what I mean? He became.
I'm sitting here with David Spade.
Yeah, Fred Wolf, and I had to correct him. Fred Wolf is a lanky guy like me, named Fred. You know, he goes.
Fred's a good guy.
Yeah. Oh, in your book, yeah, he's.
Yeah.
You know what it is about Wolf though? He's very bravado. I wished, you know, yeah, man. You know.
Well, like, you know what it is.
He goes back from bravado to self-effacing, like Stern.
Right, but I'll tell you why he's bravado. I think he has seven brothers, and they all grew up in an apartment in Spring Street in Manhattan, and they literally would box for their dinner.
I'll get out of here.
Yeah, they literally would fist fight, and the winner got.
Are you kidding me?
No. And then, so he.
But he was a skinny guy. He must have not eaten.
But he could fucking hit like a mule.
Wow.
And then he left. He's one of those guys, Fred Wolf, who, like, he'd go on, like,
He'd always brag, wrote the movie in 2 weeks. Yeah, I got that other house.
Yeah. And then, well, he's also a guy that, like, would go move to Montana and work on a ranch for 2 summers and sleep on the floor and cow shit. And then he'd do, like, Deadliest Catch. He'd work on, like, an oil rig out in the ocean. He's like one of these bizarre. Then he lived in Santa Monica in a gay neighborhood, and his apartment was all gay male prostitutes. Like, literally.
I used to live, when I first moved to LA, I'd stay with this guy, Stevie Ray Fromstein. He goes, yeah, we could be roommates. And I came up for a pilot season. He goes, nothing personal, get your own place. So it was on Hayworth. So I took the first place I saw. Don't tell anyone, not knowing in LA you could take your time. And I didn't know about the Fairfax neighborhood. And it was all gay. And I'm not doing the Seinfeld anything wrong with that joke. Ballsy if one guy goes, there is something wrong with that. You know, because everyone does.
It would be ballsy. That is the comic goes, then these two gay guys walk in, which is fucking bullshit. I ain't rolling around with, you know, what's with these gays?
There was this.
I didn't ask for that shit. I'm at TGI Fridays with my wife, and a fucking gay walks in.
There was this guy.
That, you know what? You're right, though.
But there was Not that there's anything wrong with. Be funny, Frank. He goes, not that there's anything wrong with that. Because wait a minute, maybe there is.
Or just anybody goes, what do you mean? There's nothing wrong with it. They're gay.
Yeah.
That would send me over the moon if I saw that in concert.
When I started in stand up, Steve Buscemi was named Steve Buse, and he was trying to do stand up. And Keenan Ivory
is tipping automatically for the birds.
Keenan Ivory Wayans used to run it, and he would put Steve Buscemi on because he would crack up. He would make muscles, and he'd go, you know, there's you know. And Keenan would be laughing, and one of Steve Buscemi's jokes was, you know, one thing I noticed about all these fags, they're all gay. That's not a bad
that's
impression.
That's a great joke.
You know.
That's a very good impression, by the way. And Buscemi, I just worked with on Burt Wonderstone.
Great guy.
And so great.
Oh, I auditioned for that, and I knew I wasn't going to get it because they're not going to have a guy that looks like Steve Buscemi. Who got the guy with the cat? A tiger mauled him.
Okay. I got Rick the Implausible, who's a comedy magician, and I was partnered up with the big cat magician.
Who was that?
And as the movie progresses, I was telling the listeners, and as the movie progresses, he has more and more bandages all over him, and towards the end of the movie, I'm alone watching Bert and Anton's show wearing his jacket, like it's implied he got mauled to death. It was a German comedian, Michael Herzberg, and his nickname is Bully. He's like the Jim Carrey of Germany. He's so famous. Listen, we were shooting on Fremont Street in Las Vegas.
I'm the Fred Wolf of the Grove.
You're the Fred.
I'm the Geechee guy.
Geechee guy.
People think I'm Geechee guy.
You are the Geechee guy of the
Fairfax
Hasidic Jew Fairfax neighborhood.
So
the guy, it was an actual German stand-up comic because it's just one thing Germans are known for.
Right.
It's jocularity and funny deportment.
Yeah.
But he was a super funny kid. And when we were on Fremont Street, tourists would lock their – you would hear in the middle of a take, and they would run out of their cars and go, Bully! Bully! And they'd run past Jim Carrey and Steve Carell and Steve Buscemi.
Wait. Where was the shot?
In Vegas and in L.A.
And they knew him?
Anybody that was ever in Germany in their lives, they were in Vegas from Germany and saw him with a fake mustache and a wig. And you literally, I'm not joking.
Get
one take, Jim Carrey's talking. You hear,
I think they made the right choice over me.
You hear, Bully!
I knew I wasn't going to get it because I look sort of similar to Buscemi, and they're not going to have to kind of, you know.
Do you audition often?
Not too often. To be honest,
you hate auditioning.
I hate it. If it's something like that, like, you know, when you think of coming to L.A., right? Someone like me, and I think of my.
What if I already live here? That'd be a weird thing for me to think about.
When my 20-something years here, when I think of my auditions, maybe 1% is, this is a dream. This would be cool to be in a movie with you, Carell, Buscemi. But 1%, most of them, there's nothing wrong. Health insurance is so important. But most of them is, this is sort of okay. I guess it'll help towards my health insurance, which is valid as shit. But I'm saying,
it's a very pragmatic view of a business.
Right. But maybe 1% is, yeah, so if it's a movie like that, that'd be cool, and it's very rare. Usually it's to audition for people I already work for, to go into Warner's, you go all the way to the top of Culver City Overland, you take the thing, you walk to the David Lean building.
They really make you fucking earn it these days. When you go to a studio, you used to just park your car next to where you were auditioning.
Oh, it's
and now they've all the studios have built parking lots down the street.
Oh,
you have to
and
take
you park,
a shuttle.
And you're walking with this map. And it's like the map of the gold with a yellow highlighted. You see all these other actors walking, you know. Hey, can I follow you? No. And they don't want you to follow you and get the job. And you walk there. And it's, again, I don't want to audition people I worked for before playing the nebbish clerk. I go, can't they remember, you know, what
they
I
don't.
Did? Yeah.
Because I auditioned for the same people, too.
That you worked for.
I auditioned for the movie Mr. Brooks, which Dane Cook got to be with Kevin Costner and William Hurt.
Oh, I could do it with my other Mr. Brook, the greatest movie ever. Dane Cook in it, Dom Arara. Who's that?
I don't know.
Mr. Brook. Jamie from the Laugh Factory.
I was going to guess
Moore
Jamie Masada.
With Jay, you know Jen Karam? She's a comedian.
I saw her at the acupuncturist, actually.
She was doing the we the best comic. We laugh. You guarantee
the so best what, time with a good time, buddy.
Marathon runners, you do running too slow. So one time, so he had a sign up there.
On fire. I
he's
love
like
this.
So one time, Jan was like scooping out. He helps for like. Thanksgiving.
He gets the homeless at Thanksgiving
and he goes,
every year.
No, get Jay Moore for the camera. So she got bumped by you. So, because the camera
so
was
KTLA
there.
KTLA could film me you, giving fucking.
Yeah, celebrities.
Peace.
Yeah. Do we have to have Jay Moore for camera? Jay, you go. Jan, you go away. And when I wrote my Seinfeld episode, he put a sign up. Watch Fred Stoller's episode on Seinfeld on the marquee at Seinfeld.
That's nice.
And he goes, tell Jerry. Make sure you tell Jerry. So he
listen, was, buddy. Listen. You know, all right, so what were we talking about?
What? I'm sorry to interrupt.
No, you haven't Buscemi? Interrupted at all. Buscemi going to, do you get audition? Do you get nervous when you audition?
Yeah, I'm getting, it's getting harder as I get older.
You can look so that cap actually Fred Stoller's trying to put a cap on a bottle of water without looking, and it's been going on for about 8 minutes.
You know, it's
just fucking look at it. It's a human being.
They're doing the Fred and Vinny movie. Ruined me. I didn't learn till recently. Ruined was two syllables. Ruined. So retarded.
Yeah, Brooklyn is ruined.
Yeah, ruined. So that, I've walked out of a few auditions lately.
Because you were nervous?
No, because I didn't want to be there. I'm going, even if I get this, you know, you're
hold
in
on.
A room.
This
you
is
don't
the guy
do
that,
cattle call auditions.
This
so
is the guy that plays the bellhop on Wizards of Waverly Place.
What I didn't audition for. They knew what I do.
Oh, so they offered it to you.
Yeah, no.
And to those listening, there is a huge difference. And you know what? I'll admit it.
I'll do anything
it's
if it's an offer.
It's a huge ego stroke, too. Even if it's a pile of shit. I'm not Wizards of Waverly Place. I've done things that I normally probably would never have done. But because they offered it, you get a little, you know,
yeah.
Your feathers go out a little bit. You feel a little rude.
Well, in the
90s,
it was the golden age of sitcoms. Every night, there was like five sitcoms. Remember SheTV with, you know, Suddenly Susan? Every network had, so there was so, and I used to get a lot of, again, playing delivery guys, clerks, you know, but if they offer it to me, that's the big headache, you know, reading for people. Oh, yeah, I'll do anything if it's
but
an
you
offer.
Get how, do you get nervous to the point where it's a detriment to your performance?
Yes, you know, I it took me a while to learn. And if we have time, I want to get back because about
we have
writing.
Plenty of time.
Okay. You know, it took me a while to learn that I used to like prepare, and I would all night long like be preparing the audition. It's almost like a religion, saying it over and over, like it's my Bible. Hey, and
Baruch
then I broke my toe and I'm annoyed. That's what we used to say. Nice. I broke my toe and I'm annoyed, and I couldn't think of the next line. But I would all night long, if it's a five-line part, prepare it. Then I go in the room, and what happened to 7 hours at night? And it took me a while to realize, if I'm not connected to the material, it doesn't matter how much I prepare. You know, and one thing, you know, with these small parts.
And that repetition, 7 hours, doesn't connect you to the material? If it's bad material.
If it's words I don't say. Because when you're doing like a three-line part, it's, oh, the Palmister came and I don't have dungarees. You know, you're saying either a medical jargon or you're the weird guy saying, if I go with Brooke to the ATM machine on three laps, I can't even come up with the nonsense. You know, it's not like, hey, Jay, how you doing? Oh, I was going there. Oh, I like Temecula.
It's guest star nonsense where you walk. It's like Lenny and Squiggy. Who could be that stupid? Hello. And then you walk in, say hello, and then you go, you know, I just put a new manifold in my car.
Exactly.
And you walk out.
And with the parameter of the thing.
It's hard to connect to.
Yeah, you're just saying something weird out of context.
You're setting everyone else up.
Right. So basically, it took me a while. My friend Steve Scrovan, I know, I'm sorry for going on tangents. That was part of the Larry David story. We never finished. I never finished, but.
Doug Benson said we should call this more digressions instead of more stories, so don't worry.
It's I like that. It's
Steve Scrovan.
Okay, no, but what was that? Oh, yeah. He worked on Raymond for 9 years, and he saw people auditioning. He goes, Steve, let me ask you about auditions when they come in. You know, because it took me a while to realize auditioning isn't like stand-up. Like, you don't get them, then you get them after a while. Hey, they like you. Audition, I never had anything where you're not connected. You know, they're just looking around. Then well, page three, wait a minute. They sit up. He got that beat. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like a woman. It's like either they're into you or not. I go, Steve, let me ask you, because you have 8 pages of these auditions. Do I need to let me ask you this, validate this makes sense. As long as my first beat is really specific, then I'll get them, you know. And so he goes, we know when they walk through the door. You know, you, like, I'm not going to be on NYPD Blue being the butcher going, yeah, I saw the guy, you know, and the, you know, doing the thing, or the gruff bus driver, you know what I mean? Or I'm not going to be a vice principal. I don't fit into puzzles, you know. So it took me a while. It took the pressure off auditioning that either you walk through the door, you're the guy or not. You know, I could tell.
Well, we've said on this podcast a lot, and I'm a big fan of David Mamet's book, True and False.
I love it. Love it.
The fact that you're auditioning, you're not the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you'd have an offer.